Well, I understand that Ronald Reagan was fond of telling this story about a timid little man. You can just imagine, maybe he had a bow tie and glasses. Standing at the door of the biker bar, well, he finally works up the courage and pushes the door open and very meekly asks, "Whose black pit bull is tied to the parking meter outside?" Well, of course, it is the biggest guy in the bar. You know, it's just muscles bulging out of his leather jacket. "So that's my dog. Why?" "My dog just killed your dog." "What? What kind of dog do you have?" Well, the guy finally gets the courage up to the Pekingese. You can see the veins are bulging in his neck. And the biker says, "Pekingese? How did that happen?" "I think he got stuck in his throat." Well, you know, one of our themes today is the power of little things. You know, Jesus once compared the kingdom of God to the smallest seed, the mustard seed. And when that mustard seed grows up, it becomes the biggest of bushels, nearly a tree. And the birds of the air put their nest in it, and animals find shade. You know, you wonder if Jesus ever made his way to California, what parable he might tell. You know, because we got the giant sequoias. I mean, mustard plants are okay, but you've been to Sequoia National Park. You've been to the Sequoia Groves up in Yosemite. Now that's a tree. The General Sherman tree is believed to be the most massive living thing on Earth. 275 feet tall, 108 feet wide in its girth at the bottom of the tree. But the really massive part of the sequoias is just how much there is to the tree. And it's estimated to weigh 2,756 tons. You ever see a sequoia seed? You know, those little cones, they don't even open until there's been a fire coming through. Well, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, a sequoia seed is the size of an oat flake. And it weighs 1/6,000th of an ounce. Talk about a mighty plant from a little seed. But you know, size is only one part of the story of anointing a new king. Well, you know, David was certainly small, the youngest, the one who was left behind to take care of the sheep. But more importantly, it is Samuel learning how to take measure of a man. You know, he doesn't at first see as God sees. And it's worth reflecting on this dilemma that Samuel faced. You know, and you know, which one of the sons is he going to anoint? How do you decide? Maybe, you know, we can do better with all of our new technology. David Wolpe's a rabbi at the Sinai Temple in Los Angeles, and upon learning, you know, his daughter taught him that his Apple iPhone could count his steps, you know, like the pedometers and the Fitbits. So, you know, he wrote, that information gave him an entirely new field of uselessly obsess over. He says, now does he not only check his phone all the time to see how many steps he is getting and whether maybe he should have gotten some more, but now he obsesses over the Sabbath because he doesn't carry his phone on the Sabbath and he's going, oh my, how many steps did I miss? But all that led him to think about things that cannot be measured. There is no scale for tenderness or affection, he says, writing in his synagogue's website. You cannot calibrate kindness. No matter how sophisticated our instrument, there is no computation for creativity, for love, for the depth of the human hearts. In any case, the prophet Samuel, you know, he was really in need of that kind of an app. When the Lord sent him to the household of Jesse the Bethlehemite, and among Jesse's eight sons, and he was to find a king to replace Saul, whom God had now rejected. And you know, the problem was that, you know, Samuel thinks that he needs to track activity instead of having a character tracker. When assessing the candidate for the future king of Israel, so Samuel is looking for the new king. And there are some impressive candidates, but lacking our technologies, he could just measure by the kingly qualities that you think you need in a monarch. You know, the eyeball test. Samuel tried to gauge the merit of the sons, some of whom were tall and good-looking, by their outward appearance. But God quickly squashed that, telling Samuel that the eldest seven were not God's choice. And after rejecting the eldest son, Eliab, God said, do not look on his appearance or the height of his stature, because I've rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals, but the Lord looks on the heart. And as we know, it's the youngest son, David, whom God wants for king. And essentially, Samuel was being told, hey, the Lord says, I got this. Just let me do the measuring. You know, today we have more than just our eyesight to take measure of a man. Well, you know, if you go through ordination or some job searches, you probably have been put through a battery of psychological exams. And maybe even, you know, Myers-Briggs and all the rest that come with it, multiple personality tests and such. And those exams, you know, they get a glimpse of how our emotions and our personalities guide our actions. But you know, do they really tell us what's in a man or a woman's heart? Today we are finding that we can take surveys, you know, for our own self-growth, or other people are evaluating us. But psychologists are more often looking at other measures for our behavior that they call unobtrusive measurements, which means they're not deliberately set out in a questionnaire. You know, you can't fill in the blanks or do the multiple choice. Because researchers found that the indirect ways to measure social behavior, because let's face it, you know, once you learn about these tests, you know, I can take the Myers-Briggs test and I can pick whatever personality I want to be because I know how to answer the questions. The unobtrusive approach often seeks unusual sources, such as public records, graffiti, security cam footage, public statistics, social media postings. You know, you gotta be careful what you put out there on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all those other social media footprints. Even looking through folks' garbage. In short, an unobtrusive measurement is a method of making observations and comparisons without the knowledge of those being observed. Well, you know, this is Father's Day, and so it led me to ponder about unobtrusive measurements. You know, kids growing up, we check out our fathers all the time. We kind of watch little things, and it gives us some insights. I remember when I was little, one night a week, my dad didn't eat dinner with us. You know, these were the good old days, you know, when the whole family came together and we sat at the table and we had dinner together. But one night a week, my dad was gone. And you know, sometimes we thought there was other things that we would rather do than have to come to family dinner. So we said, well, where's dad? My mom would always say, well, he's in jail. You know, it wasn't until later that I kind of figured things out. This was before they had the Match 2 program, but there was a group of the men from our church who that day of the week was their day that they went to minister with the inmates at the county jail. And when I kind of understood that, you know, that little observation let me know a little bit more about my dad's love for others and love for Jesus. You know, my dad worked for either irrigation companies or large ranches his whole career, and the Orang Ranch sent him to Spanish class, which, you know, seemed like a good idea, right? And so, you know, he went to Spanish class, he finished Spanish class, and when class was over, he bought himself a Bible, but it was a Bible all in Spanish. And, you know, he had it out and he'd be reading through it. And, you know, we always thought, hey, that's a great idea. If you want to keep your Spanish and keep it current, reading the Spanish Bible was a good tool. You know, it was years later that, you know, I figured that my dad took his Bible with him to work because, well, when the irrigation crews were taking their breaks, you know, those were the folks he managed. Well, he would sit down with them and he'd read out of the Spanish Bible. And it's like, oh yeah, he's not just doing that to look good to his bosses. He wanted to be able to talk about Jesus to the guys who work for him. So what I didn't get in the first observation would help me deeply appreciate what was on my dad's heart. So how could we look at some of those little things? And well, you know, maybe we're not measuring our dads anymore, right? You know, but we still assess ourselves. So what questions could we ask? What kind of movies and TV shows do I watch? You know, if somebody checked the ashtrays, how many cigarette butts would be out there? How much exercise did I do today or this week? Am I getting big numbers on the Fitbit? Man, I don't want to look at one of those. How would I describe my reading habits? How do I take care of my spiritual self? How much unwanted email or unanswered email is stacked up in the inbox? Would I do something unethical if I knew for sure nobody was looking? You know, that's a hard one, isn't it? I don't know how many times I've sat there in a red light thinking, there's nobody coming. But I just can't drive through it. How many people do I irritate on a regular basis? Did I go out of my way to commit a random act of kindness today? But the day's not over yet. Did I offer someone a word of encouragement today? You know, there's a lot of questions we could put on a list like this. These are the sort of ways that we start to either look at one another or, more importantly, examine ourselves and begin to see as God sees, looking at our hearts. Well, after Samuel wasted a lot of time evaluating king candidates using external measuring rubrics, God stepped in, called the hearts to the examination process. And as we noted above, God said to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. Do not look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on his heart. So the key to self-assessment then is to endeavor to see as God sees. And you know, honesty is really important. You know, we're not gonna do ourselves a lick of good if we evaluate a persona that we create that we want for other people to see. Because that's not the real deal. It is critical for our growth spiritually and relationally, that is in terms of getting along with God and getting along with others, to be honest and truthful in the process of trying to look into our inward being. You know, we don't want to just age through life. You know, life isn't like grade school where, you know, you just go through and you think you're going to get promoted because you came to school every day. Sometimes we need to consciously take an inventory of who we are. And if we don't, we're missing opportunities to become better people and better relationships with one another, and more importantly, a better relationship with God. If we really want to walk a closer walk with our Lord, if we want to become more Christ-like, we got to do those little things over and over and over again until it becomes our character and who we are. So how are you doing following Jesus? Well, it's true that only God can really fully and truly see our hearts. You know, we can learn to look in our examination for those little signs that, hey, yeah, I'm getting things right today. Just as the small details in looking at my dad's life gave me a glimpse of his faith life, we can help one another and ourselves when we look for signs of tenderness and compassion when evaluating others. And you know, if we keep it up, maybe eventually we'll get to see one another as God sees. Maybe we'll get to see one another as God wants us to be. Isn't that what we're all growing toward?